thank you, sorry. Well, good afternoon. My poster that I forgot to write the number, so it's N17. It's related with two different topics that both... sorry, but I also have to see it. I don't see it here. And they're both related to the rate variability of the substitution rate variability. And when on one side, it covers how rate variability induces memory effects on the process of protein sequence evolution. And on the other hand, I try to sketch a relationship between rate variability and coevolution. But please, for the first part of the talk, poster, please refer either to the reference or to the poster, because now, as I have not much time, I will focus on the second part. And before starting, I want to clarify that when I say rate variability, I mean the variability of the substitution rates among the sites of a protein. And well, let's come to the idea behind our model. Well, we think that a mutation catalyzes the fixation of other mutations nearby, but only for a limited time. Well, the first point is a very common point in coevolution, but we want to stress that, according to us, there must be a time damping on the effect of a mutation on the surroundings. So either compensatory mutations take place quickly, or probably they were not needed. And so we have to reduce the effect of the initial mutations. Well, with this in mind, we decided to model the rate of the sites of a protein with this formula that depends on two terms. First, we have a probability of random mutation, which is the same for all the sites at all times. But then we add a coupling, and this coupling depends on a sort of contact probability on an average structure between two sites. And then we have the exponential decay on time that I was describing to you at the beginning. Please, I want you to notice that in this model we are completely neglecting the specific information on the amino acidic sequence, but the only feature of each site is the TK, that is the time of last mutation of that site. So these quantities are enough to describe the dynamics for this kind of model. We here have officially three parameters, but tau only fixes the time scale, so it's not important, and also R0 can be fixed for our purpose. So we can say that somehow we have only one free parameter, which will be J. And we are going to analyze with this model three different quantities. The first one is the spatial correlation of substitution, so the along chain correlation that we are going to quantify as the conditional probability of substitution. So the probability to find a substitution D sites away from another one. And to know it, we gathered statistics from ungapped pairwise alignment in UniRef. We condensed the information in a sequence of 0 and 1, and we plotted this data that are in red against our model, and we see that for all the analyzed sequence identities, the agreement is very good. Well, in each panel, we optimize separately only the value of J of our model. So we are able to reproduce correctly the spatial correlation. What about the second quantity, which is the rate distribution? Of course, this model doesn't predict homogeneous rate, but after a certain amount of time, the rate distribution becomes stationary, and so we can analyze it. And what we found is that the rate distribution produced by this model is gamma distributed. And this is interesting because generally when we model it, for example, while building phylogenetic trees, this is the shape that is chosen, this is the shape that well fits data. And so we have shown that coevolution, that is the only realistic feature that we have in our model, is enough to trigger a gamma-distributed substitution rate. So probably coevolution is important in the process of rate variation, in particular of the time rate variation. Well, the last quantity that I want to discuss is how are these substitutions localized in time and space? And our model predicts that they are gathered in a sort of avalanches, localized in space and in time. And you see in this animation how the rates in yellow vary in time. And on top of it, the blue points are the points that mutated in this model. This is always the model. And what you see is that these substitutions are gathered and came in similar times. We just wanted to check if this is plausible in a real case, and we chose influenza hemagglutinin, because in this case, we do not only know the sequence at the final state, but also in the intermediate points, and so we are able to compute a similar quantity. And we found that in this case, well, you can see on, sorry, on the x-axis you have the protein site, on the y-axis the ear, and the different color codes show the substitution frequencies. And these substitutions happen qualitatively in avalanches. So of course this is not a quantitative comparison, but we do not have data to do that, but in qualitatively this system agrees with our model. Just before closing, I want to acknowledge the people that worked on this study. Alessandro and Alex were my PhD supervisors, and Stefano and Andrea now are respectively in Lausanne and in Turin.